universal consciousness reflection only, sun's reflection is sun only.
Right.
Okay, so that's why if one person gets enlightened, all others are not enlightened.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So also, the experience one, the person who gets enlightened, for him, he sees the self only in all. For him, there are no unenlightened people as such. So when Buddha got enlightened, people asked him, what did you realize first? He said, when I was awakened, I realized that the entire world is awake. So from his point of view, he is no longer seeing the reflections, he is seeing the original.
Right.
For him, there are no ignorant people.
Right.
He sees his self in all. But for other reflections,
right.
So there is still a problem.
Right.
Because they have not realized. They are images.
Power, mantra and all.
Mm-hmm.
Like, is there any, like, you know, when I look at Vedanta, it appears to me as if it's like a systematic investigation of who you are.
Yeah.
And you discard everything but which you are not.
Right.
So now, but people talk of mantra and, you know, initiation, power and all. Mm-hmm. Like, is it really true, sir? Is there any such kind thing, that kind of thing?
So,
that, you know, where people give that kind of thing?
So,
me,
everything ever true, in a limited way.
Uh-huh.
Okay, everything is a viewpoint and depends on the context.
Uh-huh.
The context is what is the maturity and evolution level of the seeker.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
So depending on where you are in your maturity.
Uh-huh.
So different methods will work to some degree.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
For example, a person, let us say, very novice. He thinks that a deity, seeing a deity in a temple is something, is what you call as darshan or seeing reality. His understanding is that level, that only. For another person, a spiritual master who has a power of initiation to a mantra will lead him to liberation. Or lead him to higher level, whatever is that. So for him, that mantra works because he is coming from a background, as what I call as a society and religious background, which takes him to that point. For him, that is the reality. For another person, the Kundalini awakening is the reality. Because of what I call as his conditioning, religious conditioning, social conditioning, so background, he has a mental understanding that this can help me.
Right.
So that will help me.
Right.
Okay. So for a dana, finally, in all the teachings, okay, these are all will take you to certain level. Okay. They will help you to make your mind calm and purify you at some extent. Each of them will work. Mantra initiation or Kundalini.
Mm-hmm.
All of them will take to a certain level.
Mm-hmm.
But the enlightenment problem is quite different.
Mm-hmm.
Enlightenment problem is a wrong identification with the body and mind.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, that can be removed only through jnana.
Mm-hmm.
Knowledge. Okay.
Right.
Because of ignorance of I am, who am I, so you are in a state of unenlightenment.
Right.
So that can be removed only through jnana, knowledge.
Right.
But that is not the attitude or aptitude of many people. They are going into different domains.
Right.
Okay, because they don't know what is ultimate.
Right.
And also in this journey, your life is anyway suffering because of all social stress and family stress and all those things.
Right.
So even if you get a little bit of bliss or happiness somewhere, you feel you got a lot.
Right.
So you start getting into that and continuing that in long way. So in that sense, everything works to some degree. I will say, for a cancer, every treatment works to some degree. A painkiller works to some level. A chemotherapy works for some level. But ultimately, it requires a surgical treatment where the cancer has to be removed. Similarly, in the journey, many things to work and take you to a certain level of understanding. Finally, only dana can liberate.
Right.
So this is what we call as nahi dnanena sadrasham pavitramiho dite. Nothing is more purifying than dnana. Nothing is more purifying than dnana. Dnana vi dagda karmani. The knowledge, the fire of knowledge will burn all your ignorance. But depending on their karmic impressions, vasanas, people go to different types of practices and they find happiness there. But finally, they have to come to dnana. It is said that great sage, incarnation of Chaitanya Prabhu, he was a great soul in what you call as bhakti, devotion. Finally, he had to go through a guru who gave him jnana. That's what I have heard. So no doubt, everything else helps in a degree of purification, what is called chitta shuddhi. So that can prepare you for final jnana. This is my view, and this is the view of Ramana Maharshi, this is the view of Shankaracharya, this is the view of scriptures. Absolutely, Ishvara is existing. You have to get a teaching of Ishvara from a qualified teacher. So right now, all these concepts you are picking up from the society and some books here and there, what you have read. Any of these understandings has to be clarified through a guidance of a competent teacher. Right now, you are individual. So, look around. There is an infinite order in the universe. It's not a chaos.
Right.
The whole huge stars, planets, galaxies, they are going in with an order. Enormous order is there in the universe. And you know, without infinite intelligence, that order cannot be maintained. See, if there's no intelligence, you cannot write one page of note on a notebook. How much intelligence is required to run this whole universe? So there is an order called universal order. So then there is an order in your body-mind complex, biological order. Everything in your body-mind complex is operating very, very precisely. There is an order in the electron level, subatomic level. Everywhere, there is an infinite order. Without the order, it will fall into chaos. So that order is coming from intelligence, which is far superior. and that intelligence is what we call as Ishvara. So that is available to you right now. I mean, that is obvious to you. Yeah, so that
creation is happening, things are growing.
Yeah,
my volition is
yeah.
happening.
So that order and the intelligence behind that order is called Ishvara. It's not a matter of belief, it's a matter of experience. There's an order. Okay, so now the order is sustaining life. You see, the environment, millions and millions of life forms are living depending on each other. Okay, right? There's a lot of order in nature, the seasons, the way animals are born, animals grow, animals die. So there's a biological order, there's nature, the natural order, there's a cosmic order, there's a order at the subatomic level. So this order is what we call as intelligence. This order, if there's requires intelligence, we call it as Ishvara. You can call it as intelligence, whatever is it. Okay, so from that perspective, Ishvara is real because that's our experience. There is an order. Okay. Ishvara is unreal when you say I am separate from Ishvara.
Okay. Okay.
So it's all pervading reality. You cannot be separate from Ishvara. So you have separated yourself from Ishvara conceptually by identifying the body and mind. So the moment once you identify yourself with Ishvara, then there is no concept of Ishvara because you have become one with Ishvara.
Okay.
So right now, you can conceptualize Ishvara as an infinite intelligence operating throughout the universe. So from that perspective, Ishvara is very, very real because you can see the order. You can see that there is an order, there is an enormous amount of order. So when the Ishvara is mithya, when it is said, it doesn't mean there is no Ishvara, there is no false Ishvara, there is no Ishvara is not there. It doesn't mean that. Once you become with Ishvara, there is no separation. Then there is no conceptualization of Ishvara possible for you. Okay, I'll give you an example. One salt doll is there. Okay, salt doll knows that ocean is full of salt.
Right, right.
Okay. So now it is able to see ocean is infinite, very big.
Right, right.
Is ocean real? Yes. Is salt in the ocean real? Yes.
Right.
Then the salt doll goes and wants to experience the ocean.
Right.
In that experience, salt doll disappears.
Right, right.
Ocean remains.
Right,
so similarly, for you are the salt doll now. For you, the ocean is real. The infinite ocean or Ishvara is real at this point of time because you can see the order.
Right, right.
But if you have a desire to experience that infinite intelligence, you become one with that infinite intelligence. So then there is no separation. Then there is no conceptualization. Then the Ishvara alone is there. All right. This is what is meant by, this is what is the meaning of Vedantic teaching.
Right, right.
So when I say it's mithya, the mithya is not false or unreal as you understand in English.
Right, right.
Okay, mithya is experiential reality. Okay, as long as the experience lasts, it's very real. Once the experience goes, it is not real, it's not there. So right now, Ishvara is your experiential reality because you are seeing that infinite order everywhere. You tell me where there is no order, where there is chaos.
Right, right, right.
So as long as you are not merged with Ishvara, for you, Ishvara is real. And the moment you merge with Ishvara, that question doesn't arise.
Okay, thank you, sir. This is a big clarification for me, actually.
Okay.
Because I was actually thinking of Ishvara, thinking of the oneness with a separated mind, actually.
Yeah.
So, then it becomes, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And this brings a lot of clarity to me.
Okay.
So, now, as I understand right now, the fact that once you realize your oneness with the universe, you there is only Ishvara, and there is no separate thing.
There is no you. There is no knowing. There is simply Ishvara. Okay. There is you. You don't realize oneness. You realize there is oneness only.
Okay.
Then there is no you and oneness. That's again your concept, okay? Beautiful state you are conceptualizing now. Okay? So, when you are in that state, when there's not a state actually, it's your reality. Once you are one with Ishvara now also, but you are not able to recognize that. Okay? It is not a new experience. It is a recognition of existing experience which is already there, but you are ignoring it. Overpowered by sense organs and the body. That's what I'm saying, no. There's a order of Ishvara, there's a creation. The creation is an order. Okay? So creation has an experience. Experience you'll go through so many levels of experience. Finally you realize. So there's an order in that also. That's what it's called.
Right.
Eventually you'll go into realization. When you ask a higher power, okay, already I have told you about higher power. There is a tremendous order everywhere. You are not recognizing that tremendous order.
Right.
So the tremendous order only will take you. Whether
it's
Ramana Maharshi or anybody.
Right.
Only Ramana Maharshi has verbalized it.
Mm.
The tremendous order is the universe, Ishvara.
Mm.
So you are actually, are you not breathing?
Yeah.
Are you able to think?
Yeah.
Is your heart not beating? Is your mind not working towards what is self-realization?
Right.
This is that higher order, higher principle, Ishvara.
Right.
Do you think you are doing this thinking?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let me ask you the question. Do you think?
Right. Of course.
Okay, are you sure that you think? So, your statement that I am thinking is false.
Mm-hmm.
The thoughts occur to me is more closer to reality than I am thinking.
Mm-hmm.
The moment you say I am thinking, it appears as though thinking is a conscious volitional act.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at your life, every thought is appearing in your consciousness rather than you are thinking.
Right.
In other words, I will say you don't think. Thinking happens in you.
Right.
So now, who does the thinking happening in you?
It's happening. It's happening that way.
That is Ishvara. That is the higher power. So to bring a clarity. How many cells are there in your brain? You don't even know how many cells are there. It's billions. Right?
Right.
And the interconnection between cells, how much is possible?
Any number of ways. Infinite number of combinations.
It is trillions and trillions, more than the number of stars and planets there in the galaxy.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
To one thought to occur, a couple of neurons have to be connected in a specific way. Otherwise, the thought will not come.
Right. Absolutely.
Okay? Now, did you do that connection?
It happened.
It happened because of the higher power called Ishvara.
Right.
You didn't do it.
Right.
Okay, now Ramana, you understand what Ramana Maharshi says, higher power has taken over me. Higher power has not taken over Ramana Maharshi, higher power has taken over everybody. Only Ramana Maharshi is able to tell it in verbally, that's all.
Okay.
Yeah. So again, I did not think about this in this way. You look over the sentence and understand what you are saying.
Yeah.
So what is the fallacy in that?
Yeah. Well, I'm actually taking the ownership of thinking.
Huh?
I'm taking the ownership of thinking.
You're taking the ownership of thinking. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So now I am pointing out that fallacy in that. So this is also because of the higher power called Ishvara. Ishvara is pointing to you. There is a fallacy in your thinking. So that is the meaning of grace.
Beautiful. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. Any questions are there?
One final question, sir.
You can ask any number of questions. As long as you want to sleep, you can ask the questions. I have no problems.
Taking your time too much.
No, I have no problems. I am saying as long as you have genuine questions, I am ready to answer even whatever amount of time you want.
Sir, one thing that I have understood is that, see, now that we have discussed the sense of, taking ownership of, thinking and doing and all that. This is what generally we tend to do mistake, and you have rightly pointed out to me that do a tip or something like that.
Yeah.
So now if everything is, it looks like, as you said, there is a lot of order in the universe, and there is everything is happening.
Mm-hmm.
And there are billions of neurons, and then there are one thought to appear, there are different pathways, and just have to come at it in particular way.
Hmm.
And we are not doing that. Now if that's the case, right? So then there cannot be any individual volition as such. But for example, I say, but the thought, even the thought that I am thinking, I am doing it, is also a part of universal order, is it not?
Yes, of course it is.
Okay. I keep on stumbling about this fact is that, I need to realize, and, I have to put an effort to realize, and, I'm actually making it a little bit of, put a strain on myself, actually.
When you say I am putting strain on myself, what is this myself you are speaking of?
What is this sentence?
You are saying I am putting a strain on myself. So what is your self? Does the self has a strain?
I experience the strain. No, so then, theoretically speaking, the self cannot do anything, or cannot take ownership of anything. It's not my experience, actually.
So, that is again another illusion. Okay, this is all part of the Maya.
Uh-huh.
Okay?
Uh-huh.
So, these are also, I am straining, I am struggling, all those things are also part of the Maya. Through Jnana, you have to get rid of all these wrong understandings.
We are so conditioned to believe this, that you know, that you know, I'm training, or like, you know, it happens so naturally to us that we don't even recognize that.
Many times what is natural is not natural.
Right.
The sky appears to be blue, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Very naturally it appears to be blue, but it's not at all blue.
Mm-hmm.
The water appears in a desert,
mm-hmm.
but there is no water.
Right.
So these are all called optical illusions or tricks of the mind. No, you don't have to keep telling me one final question. You can ask as many questions you want. There's no limitation. It's not time limited or question limited.
Thank you. Thanks for that. I appreciate it.
Okay.
This thing, you know, like, you know, then I'm confused at a point where, sir, you know, like, there is this order in the universe and it is helping me out. There are thoughts coming up, there are things going on.
Mm-hmm.
Yet there is this identification also. You know, now is it within my control? Because at least, you know, when I look at this obviousness of the fact that, you know, I'm getting, rather I would say, like, you know, there is this natural tendency to identify with thoughts. Rather I would say, you know, like, you know, this is appearing naturally, as you said earlier.
Mm-hmm.
So is it also a part of Maya, or rather I would say, like, bondage?
The observer identifying with the thought and observer not identifying with the thought. Because I see, like, you know, whatever thought that comes in the mind is not in my control. Now what actually is in my control? What is the sadhana that I need to do then?
Sadhana is, you have to recognize through Viveka and Vairagya, you have to recognize your true nature.
Mm.
Your true nature is the Sakshi, the witness.
Mm.
True nature of witness is Brahman. Mm.
So
this you have to and realize through authentic teaching. That's all what you have to do.
Alright, so that means that recognition, how is it done? Is it driven through the process of inquiry, right? And the inquiry is a process of reflection and you know, asking, looking at the assumptions one by one, and cutting them off.
Correct.
Right. So now this is what it is. I don't know, sir, if this is the right question to ask you, but. If that's the case, right, now there are, me being the Brahman, there are these thoughts appearing, and this
looking at recognizing that I am Brahman, or I am the only observer, not.
Hello. Hello? Hello?
I think we lost him.
I'll cut the call and call him.
Yes.
Hello,
yeah, call got cut. I'm joining Srividya again. Hello, Gayatri, 1 minute. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what is the question?
The question is that, me, the observer, actually, now the question is that where is the mistake? The mistake is that I, the consciousness, the witness, is actually identifying with thought.
Okay.
Is it not the identifying with thoughts or body or mind, anything? And it is identifying with itself, with these thoughts, and
thinking itself to be separate from whatever is there out there.
Correct.
Right. So this is the fundamental problem.
Right.
Now the knowledge. This is what it is. So the identification is happening, and I did not choose to do that. Right.
Identification is happening. Two factors have contributed to that. Okay. One is forgetfulness of your nature. Second thing is the force of sense objects and conditioning happening through the society. These two things have led to that. Okay. So when you say I didn't do it, of course you didn't do consciously, but you are deeply conditioned by the society, and you are forgetful of your own nature. Even though you are forgetful of your nature consciously, deep subconsciously or unconsciously, you are craving for that. So that's the situation. Right now, you are living in an unconscious way in your own nature. I mean, the best example I can give for this is somebody has gone for a movie. He is so immersed in the movie that he has forgotten himself that he is watching the movie. That's what is happening. When you say, I didn't do it, obviously you are actually so much experiencing the sense objects as reality. When you say, I didn't do it, there's nobody else who has done it also. Okay, the self is, there's only one self and that's what you are. Okay, so somebody else comes and does something trouble for you? No. It's your own experience, you are immersed in that experience, that's why you've forgotten.
Right. So, and it is not my mistake also, right? And I'm thinking that it happened because my attention was dragged into it.
It is but natural process. It's nothing mistake or error problem in that.
Right. So it's all okay. So now the only effort, the only thing what I can do is to realize the situation that you know, this is how things are happening. And once I do look at that thing, probably the natural inclination to come out of will come. Is it not so, sir?
Can you restate again?
I'm so immersed in the movie that I forgot about myself.
Correct.
Right? I forgot my position where I am. I forgot that I'm sitting in a chair, but I'm so immersed in the movie that I take one of the characters to be. Character.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, what is the criteria that I will remember myself? You know, is it that, you know, the movie, is it that you know, something has to happen in the movie that has to shake me up, or rather, you know, is there anything that I can do for myself seeing this thing?
See, as I told you earlier, the movie is going on and you are so immersed in the movie.
Right.
So you are driven by the movie.
Right.
And you are seeking happiness in the movie.
Right.
You come to a point where I want to seek happiness in myself, not in the movie. So then you have to go through a process of yoga, which is called karma yoga, bhakti yoga, whatever, kriya yoga.
Right.
So they will purify you to some degree. Finally, you have to come to jnana yoga. So jnana yoga has two aspects. One is study of Vedanta under the guidance of a competent teacher. Or find a Sadguru, realized master, and subject yourself to the questions or inquiry in his presence.
Right.
So that's all. Right. That's the only thing which is required.
Right.
There is no other way.
Right.
So a competent teacher has two qualifications. It's called Shrotriyam, Brahmanishtam. Shrotriyam means, Brahmanishtam means he himself should be realized. Then Shrotriyam means he should be able to communicate the Vedantic truths in a very effective manner to you. So that's what is the requirement. Once you find, once you get that teaching from him, you are done.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, actually. This you have actually helped me a lot in terms of, you know, bringing that finer understanding that, you know, you, that nitty-gritty will be there, right?
Very good. Yeah. Good.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. So, whatever question answer what we have given to you on the phone, there's nothing personal about you.
Right.
So, these question answers are also as relevant to somebody else. Any, some people are there. Maybe relevant to somebody else. Some other speakers.
Right.
So that's why I have recorded this question answers, and this question answer will be published in my WhatsApp group.
Right, sure, sir.
Are you okay with it?
Right. Oh, absolutely, sir. If it helps anybody, I'm more than happy, more than glad to.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Now, sir, if I have some more questions, can I call you, sir?
Yeah, you can pick up some time and call.
Sure, sir. Definitely, I'll message you before.
Yeah.
A day before, having this conversation.
No problem.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.